I'd like to welcome you to the Award a National Lecture session. You just noticed the memorial slides that we had. One consequence of this being our 60th annual meeting and the society becoming more and more mature is unfortunately some of our members are passing away. So it's unfortunate, but they've made great contributions to biophysics. So tonight we're going to first honor the people who put together this wonderful program. So we have an award committee which involved Olga Butka, Enrique de la Cruz, a program committee that involved Olga Butka, Enrique de la Cruz, Karen Fleming, Samantha Harris, Antoine Van Ooyen, David Piston, Catherine Royer, David Rueda, and Claudia Weigel. And it was chaired wonderfully by both Vasanti Jayaraman and Michael Ostap. So if Vasanti and Michael could come up here. So having once done that, I know that it's an enormous amount of work. I did tell them initially that it was no work, it's gonna be a lot of fun, and they'll make many new friends, but that may not have been the case. So in any case, we constantly strive to bring in new people into building this program, and I hope you'll see that the program this year reflects that flux of people, and that you don't have the same people speaking every year, which differentiates ourselves from many other societies. So last evening, we had 82 students participating in the Student Research Achievement Award competition. And judges were selected from each of the 14 current subgroups within the society. The awardees, in no particular order, are Pauline, please come up. Reina Adabo. Mikael Neeson. Jason Paxman. Gul Zers. Ishutesh Jain. Warawan Limpitickle. Please keep in mind that it's been a long-standing tradition in the Biophysical Society of mispronouncing the names of many of the awardees. Caitlin Cornell. Sarah Kim. Federico Comitani. Martina Arignato. Bogdan Iparov. Yan Yan. Chalpan Tiliganova. I'd like to congratulate all of the awardees for their contributions, and you know, I hope you'll appreciate that this is part of the future of biophysics. So, you have the. Okay. Okay. Thanks very much. Thank you. Now, we have awarded this year 9 members to be fellows of the Biophysical Society. This awards long-standing service and commitment to the field of biophysics and long-standing contributions. It's a level of scientific excellence that we think should be acknowledged by giving this title of Fellow of the Biophysical Society. So this year's fellows are Mario Amsel, Charlie Brooks, oh, sorry. So for each of these, I should acknowledge why they are being given this distinction. Okay, thank you. So Mario from Johns Hopkins University is being cited for his outstanding contributions to structural biology and protein physical chemistry, for disseminating biophysical approaches, and for promoting science research and education in developing countries. Charlie Brooks from University of Michigan has been cited for his pioneering work in the development and application of computational biology tools to complex multi-scale problems in biology and biochemistry. And let me give each of you a plaque. Yes, please stay here, okay? Walter Chazen, Vanderbilt University, for his pioneering work using NMR and other biophysical techniques to relate the structure and dynamics of proteins to their biological function. Jane Clark, University of Cambridge, is being cited for her role as an international leader in the field of protein folding and for influencing the way we think about protein folding and proteins in general. Angel Garcia, Los Alamos National Laboratory, is being recognized for his contributions to understanding the structure and stability of biomolecules. Antoinette Killian, Utrecht University, for her outstanding contributions to and leadership in the field of membrane biophysics. Eduardo Perazzo, University of Chicago, for his leadership and fundamental contributions to ion channel biophysics. Matthias Rief, Technical University of Munich, for his pioneering development and applications of single molecule force spectroscopy to solve major problems in protein folding and dynamics, protein ligand interactions, and functions of molecular motors. Well, we can FedEx the plaque to him. Nancy Thompson, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. For contributions to the field of cell membrane biophysics, especially in the development and application of methods in quantitative fluorescence microscopy. So, thank you all. Thank you. The Society honors service in the field of biophysics through its Distinguished Service Award. And the recipient this year is Yale Goldman, University of Pennsylvania School of Medicine. For his outstanding and innovative scientific research, effective and generous mentoring, leadership in the society, and serving as a role model for biophysicists for over four decades. The Emily Gray Award recognizes society members who have made significant contributions to education in biophysics. Doug Robinson, Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine, is this year's recipient for the development of his outreach efforts targeting high school students from disadvantaged backgrounds. So, Doug. Now, before I get to the national lecturer, let me just mention that the Anna Trace, Avanti, Dayhoff, Barani, Founders, and Biophysical Journal of the Year awards will be presented at the awards symposium, which will take place tomorrow, 10:45, in Petrie Hall C. So we invite and encourage all of you to come and hear those award presentations where scientific talks will be given. So let me first, before introducing David, just mention that nominations for next year's awards are due by May 1st, 2016, and we encourage everyone to submit nominations. These awards really come from the membership of the society. They're not top down, and we urge all of you to try and help recognize those who are making the largest contributions to the society and biophysics itself. So the greatest honor that we give each year is the National Lecturer. And the National Lecturer this year, as you can see, is David Shaw, who's gonna talk about MD, molecular dynamics simulations, molecular movies. But I first wanna just jump back a couple of hundred years and give a very, very short introduction to this topic, starting with Nicolas Lemery, who was a French chemist from the 17th century, who was the first key and most frequently cited proponent of vitalism, which is the view that life cannot be reduced to physical principles, that there's a vital force that explains how molecules from animate objects behave differently from those from inanimate ones, and that therefore chemistry and physics cannot explain biology. He was the one who invented the designation of animal, vegetable, and mineral as being separate categories of molecules or substances. This is before they really knew about molecules. This subsequently led to a distinction of organic versus inorganic, which you'll frequently see today when you go to produce departments in supermarkets. The notion, however, at that time was that inorganic materials do not contain the vital force of life. Well, that's been debunked quite extensively. And if you think back to Isaac Newton, who transformed human thought by postulating that the laws that govern an apple falling from a tree are the same laws that govern the motion of planets around the sun, then you'll realize that molecular biology, beginning in about the 1940s, extended that to show that those very same laws govern the interactions and dynamics of the molecules that constitute all living things. So David is going to talk about this, and I just want to put this in perspective. So let me first say something about David's background. He received, because I would much rather hear him speak than me going on about vitalism. He received his PhD from Stanford University in 1980 in computer science, and then served on the faculty at Columbia University in the computer science department until 1986, when he made a small foray out of academia into the area that he helped found, which was computational finance. Now, he had some modest success in that area, I'm joking, because as a result of developing new tools, approaches, and hardware in the area of finance, D.E. Shaw and Company today has assets of approximately $40 billion. Now, I should just point out that in many respects, computational finance is very similar to computational biophysics. The only difference is that the profits are much larger in computational finance. So in 2001, David began building a scientific team and moving into his own research area at DE Research, and he resumed his affiliation with Columbia in 2005. In terms of the many, many awards that he's gotten and recognition for his scientific work, as opposed to the work in finance, he was appointed to the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Technology by President Clinton in 1994, and again by President Barack Obama in 2009. He is the two-time winner of the ACM Gordon Bell Prize and was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2007 and the National Academy of Engineering in 2012 and the National Academy of Sciences in 2014. So at this point, he holds an appointment as a senior research fellow at the Center for Computational Biology and Bioinformatics at Columbia, and as an adjunct professor of biochemistry and molecular biophysics at the Columbia School of Medicine. So with that, I'd like to introduce David. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it. Good. Just one thing. How long do I know what the rough time is, but how long before you throw me out?
50 minutes.
Okay. Good, an hour, that's great. Okay, let me just start by saying a little bit about our research group. It's kind of an unusual one in that it's extremely interdisciplinary. What we do is, first of all, develop algorithms and then also computer hardware, specialized supercomputer hardware, to do just one thing, which is high-speed biomolecular simulation. And then the goal of the work and what we spend most of our time doing in the other half of our group is to study dynamics, to study three-dimensional motions of proteins, and then try and understand in particular the mechanisms underlying various sorts of biological processes, both endogenous ones and then also looking for the potential for designing pharmaceuticals that interact with proteins with the ultimate goal of curing some people. In particular, the tool that we use, it's really the only thing we do, is molecular dynamics simulations. And I'm going to spend a little time today, because I understand not everybody here, many of you are experimentalists, but not everybody here is familiar with that process, but I also want to say some things about MD simulations that may seem a little bit technical, but speak to two questions, one of which is why it makes sense to do simulations over very long periods of biological time, and then also a major thing I want to focus on today is what sorts of things are wrong with MD simulations? What are the weaknesses? And hopefully what we can do about it, but even if we can't, what can we learn from those weaknesses? So I'll have to show you a little bit about the physical models that are used there to understand that part. So let me start just by showing you an example, a movie of an MD simulation. This one is actually of a protein called GPW, except it would be great if it worked, there we go, which was not terribly interesting to us from a biological viewpoint. The thing that is, can you see the cursor? Yeah. We're interested in, this is about a 250 microsecond simulation, which was very long by the standards when we ran it, about 25 times longer than the longest. When you saw that big excursion from that native folded state, those are the kind of big changes that we're really interested in our group, and that weren't possible to see with much shorter simulations. I'm actually going to show this slide again just to give you a sense, this movie again, to get a sense for what the comparative time scales are, because it's really a qualitative difference that we were interested in there, not purely a quantitative one. But let me first just tell you a little bit about what an MD simulation looks like, and in particular, just to give a feeling for why it takes so long, why that duration of the simulation is so challenging. So the basic idea behind molecular dynamics simulation is very simple from a computational viewpoint. It's basically an initial value problem. And so what you do is you cut time up into a lot of little discrete time steps. And the problem is each of those has to be very short, on the order of a femtosecond or so, for technical reasons. Basically, if you don't have very short time steps, atoms move too far and they sort of collide with each other and you get a big explosion and the energy goes crazy and the whole thing doesn't work. It becomes an unstable system. So you have to look at very short time steps, and then for each one of those time steps, you have to do an operation that is quadratic, at least in the simplest case. So imagine here that you've got, I hope this works and you can see it. Let's take a look at this atom here in blue. You have to figure out the strength of the interactions between this atom and all of those other surrounding atoms. So conceptually, at least, the length of time that you're going to have to take for each time step is proportional to the square of the number of atoms, rather than to the number of atoms themselves. And you can play some tricks so that distant things you can do better than that, but that's sort of in an ordinary MD simulation becomes the inner loop. That's the part that's the rate limiting step. When you've done that, for each one of those interactions, what you're going to have to do is analyze what's called a force field. It's basically a quantity. This is actually in the potential energy form. And what you're going to do is for each one of those pairwise forces, you'll evaluate an additive function, which is the sum of five terms. I won't spend much time on this, but just to give you a rough idea, these first three are bonded terms, so things that are covalently bonded to each other or within two to three links. There you're going to use a very simple approximation, which in the case of these stretch and bend terms is harmonic, and then there's a, somehow this disappears a lot, a trigonometric relationship. The stretch is how far the distance between the bonded atoms, the bend is the preferred bond angle, and the torsion is how it turns around. So each of these things has a preferred distance, and you just penalize it for any diversion from that distance in a quadratic fashion. But the part that takes the most time is these non-bonded terms, and that's because these are atoms that aren't, they're in the same molecule, but they are, or sometimes different ones, but they're not covalently bonded, and there are just a lot more of those interactions. The first one here of those terms is the electrostatic interaction, the Coulomb interaction, which you'll remember from high school, in fact. Then the other one here is kind of a weird term. It's a representation of the van der Waals interaction with a form called the Leonard-Jones approximation, and it's got two terms. Basically, the first term is repulsive, and It's a funny kind of measure. It has to do with the anti-symmetry properties of fermions, and basically just says that electrons like to be close together but not overlapping. So you can think of these two atoms as, one over r to the sixth term says they should be together, and then the one over r to the 12th term just says, but not too close together. The van der Waals part turns out to not be the biggest problem because it's only short range interactions, but if you have to just think of one thing when you think of MD simulations, think of electrostatic interactions. You know, opposite charges attract, the same charge repels, and you got to do that for all these pairwise forces. And that's not so bad, except that again, you're doing it for a quadratic number of atoms and over these hugely, very fine number of time steps, and you do a lot of them. When you're done with that, it's very easy. You just take the forces you've calculated on each atom, move it a little bit in that direction, and then repeat the process over and over again. But the time scale we were interested in is on the order of many microseconds to milliseconds, and 1 millisecond translates into 10 to the 12th time steps. So this is the sort of thing that was just well beyond the capability of an ordinary general purpose supercomputer, even the fastest ones in the world. So just to give you a sense of the numbers, before we completed our first special purpose machine, the longest simulation that had ever been done was 10 microseconds in length. But we're interested in the large number of things that happen between 10 microseconds and 10 milliseconds or so, which includes lots of protein-protein interactions and also proteins with nucleic acids, and with small molecules inside the body, and in particular with things that could be, ligands that could be turned into drug molecules. A lot of that stuff just, you couldn't see it with the 10 microsecond time scale. And also, increasingly, we're interested in allosteric changes. What kinds of structural changes are induced by what? And a lot of those things take place over these long time scales as well. So what we did is built a special purpose machine for that, which we called Anton. It only does molecular simulations, but it does those really, really fast. And at this point, it's about 180 times faster than the world's fastest general purpose supercomputers, but it only does one thing. It's not that we're smarter than those supercomputer designers. We just have the luxury of designing for one particular thing. We've got a couple dozen machines that are now operational, and each one can do multi-microsecond simulations. One of them, I should mention, some of you have used it, but one of them we make available without any cost for the research community at the National Resource for Biomedical Supercomputing. We don't choose the recipients, the National Academies does, and so far 132 research groups have received allocations and done research, and the publications are starting to come out now, including a bunch of things that I would never have thought of and members of our group haven't. So, just an ad, if you want to apply for time there, we are delighted to see other people do it. So just to visualize, and then I'll move on to the various applications, things you can do with MD simulations, and things that you can't, at least at this point. But let me just show you again this simulation that was run on Anton 1. So it's, we run up to 10 milliseconds or so, so this is a 40th of that length of time, but long enough to see these big changes, as I mentioned before. And if you, I might as well just move ahead, you probably remember how long that was. But with the longest previous simulations before we got started, this is how far that would move during that period of time. So watch closely. It would be about that long. So that's not bad. And in fact, it's compressed into a small amount of time. And also, the Anton simulation that you saw was heavily smoothed. If you just saw something that long and saw it at the level of detail people were setting before, you'd see a big blur. Some of those little blurry motions are very interesting, and a lot was learned, but you don't see those big, long structural changes that you see here, I think, of just replaying it. So we were interested in the long timescale changes. Now, I want to give you some feeling for some of the things that you can do with very long MD simulations. In fact, previous national lectures have talked about simulations of various sorts, including Klaus Schulten, who talked about MD simulations. And here, you know, he does a lot of things that are shorter, but on very big systems, and a lot of very clever, biologically important studies. We focus on single, very long trajectories, as opposed to a lot of short trajectories. The latter is something other people are doing with great discoveries. It's a very interesting technique, but you can discover different things with these two techniques. So let me just show you some things that we've done with single, very long trajectories. And we'll run other studies, but where each trajectory is a long one. And I'm going to start with protein folding. The protein folding, I didn't even used to have that, this on the comparable slide before, because it's an area of great scientific interest, sort of a long-standing problem to understand just how protein folding works on a sort of detailed structural level. But also now, increasingly, it's become clear that a lot of diseases, including most famously but not exclusively a lot of neurodegenerative diseases, are caused by some defect in folding, misfolding that can result, for example, in aggregation, as in Alzheimer's disease, for example. Also, sometimes in changing the folding in such a way that they can't be, this protein can't be appropriately degraded, so they accumulate in the cell even if they're not aggregating altogether. Sometimes also misfolded proteins can get directed to the wrong compartment within a cell where they do damage. There are also some structures and substructures that are toxic in themselves. So the misfolded either intermediates or the final structure wind up killing different kinds of cells. So that's another reason why this kind of study can be important now. And then also there are some areas that are understood less than protein folding in general. One of the interesting ones is proteins that are unfolded in their native state. You know, most proteins, what they do is they fold up in vitro conditions, in most cases, into a single native structure, a single three-dimensional conformation. But there are some that most of the time are unstructured. And then when they bind to other structures, other proteins, or other ligands, they can assume a shape. Or sometimes with a different ligand, they assume an entirely different shape. Or they're partially unfolded structures where part of it is rock solid, but there are other parts that wander around, and then they can bind in different ways and assume different structures upon binding. And that may be something that is useful in terms of binding to different counterparts, and maybe can be something that could be manipulated in drug design when you're trying to achieve selectivity and specificity. So there are interesting things there. It's worth mentioning, though, because I do want to cover a lot of the problems with MD, that representing those kinds of folding events is one of the things that MD has had a lot of trouble with. You find many examples, and I'll mention some, where you get remarkably good agreement with what's known experimentally about the folding process. And then when you look at unfolded proteins, when we were able to look at them for long enough to see what really happened, what we found is that we were coming up with dramatically wrong, very simple parameters. For example, if you took certain unfolded proteins and tried to watch them fold, the initial step resulted in a very quick and artificially and incorrectly a small aggregation. It would fold up into a little compressed ball, and experimentally we know it doesn't do that. And various other parameters. Some of them were very good, but other things were especially bad when we looked at unfolded proteins. And I'll talk more about force field issues. Some of them we've sort of done some work to understand a little bit of it and come up with some, you know, little tweaks to force fields that tend to improve it, but we don't really understand that. And I think we as a field don't fully understand what's wrong with some of those physical models that we use. Another one, which is one of the ones that has been talked about for a long time, in practical terms, I'm not really sure how important it is or whether it's important at all, but one of the dreams was to be able to predict three-dimensional protein structures from the amino acid sequence of a protein. And, you know, just the simplest one would be ab initio protein folding, where you start with an extended polypeptide chain and watch it as it folds up, hopefully, into the native structure. That's really hard. It doesn't always work. And if you have any other alternatives for doing it, usually that's a better way to do it. I just put it in here for completion. But we in our group tend to be more interested in the dynamics anyway, and what the process of folding actually looks like. So this was the first time that a protein had been folded computationally, which I guess was about 6 years ago or so. It's a very simple one. It's a WW domain, specifically one called FIP35. And we did a long simulation, longer than anybody had done, and actually saw this protein fold. So what I'm going to show you is the protein. I hope the colors, yeah, they're less on my screen, but you can see here. This orange one is a randomly extended chain, and then the native structure is in gray here. Sorry? What's happening? Microphone. You can't hear it when I turn over there. Okay, so you can either see or you can hear. Let me just say it again. So the gray, well, I'll start the other order. This gray part is the experimentally known three-dimensional structure of this WW domain, and then the orange part here is a randomly extended chain, and you're going to see it try and fold up into the structure. Yell out at me again if I forget, because I probably will. Oh, you know what? This isn't supposed to matter. I'll bet. Is this working? If we turned up the volume of this and ignored that, that should work. You can all hear me now? Good. No, you can't. How did you know what I said then? Sorry. Is there some? There we go. How about now? Can you guys hear? Wave at me if you can. Yes. Hi. Okay. Good. So let me tell me again if this doesn't work, but let me just show you this folding. So it wanders around a lot. The native structure is one that has two beta hairpins and one tends to form before the other, and there it gets very, very close to the native structure in simulation. And this is actually cheating because I cut it off right at the point in the slide where it wanders off a little and then comes back, but it really does look pretty much like the protein. And we learned various things about that, about the order in which those things occurred, but also just to test it, because we try and look not just at historical experimental data, but to make some predictions and see whether they come true as a test for whether we're seeing something real. So one of the things that we did is we, in looking at this and finding out what residues were key, we wound up proposing, I guess it was three mutations, I don't even have that here, but three residues which, when substituted, ought to make it fold better if our model was correct. And then Martin Grublet tested that in his lab, and indeed that turned out to be the fastest folding beta sheet protein. Later, what we did, a couple years later, I guess, was to simulate the folding of a number of other proteins. And these are all, I should emphasize, because sometimes I forget, these are all small proteins, mostly engineered in order to fold fast. And both small and especially proteins with a very simple free energy landscape, there's no reason to believe that they'll really fold in the same way as larger proteins. So we've done a little on larger ones, but it's worth keeping that in mind. In any case, 11 out of the 12 proteins did fold correctly. And the way we incidentally chose these was Bill Eaton had identified a bunch of proteins, including a number of these. And I think we chose either two or three other ones because we wanted more coverage of some mixed alpha-beta proteins and so forth. But 11 out of the 12 folded correctly. And then I may or may not have this in a slide. Yeah, there was one of them that did not fold, but it was one that's known experimentally to not be very thermostable, and so we folded a variant that folded correctly. That's cheating, of course. You know, that one did not fold, but it helped us understand some of what was wrong in this case. And just in the interest of time, I'm not going to say much about this, but the bottom line is we looked at order of formation. One of the big questions had been, and remains so in larger proteins, when proteins fold, do they follow the same route, the same, you know, every time it's different. These are chaotic processes where they move around somewhat differently, but if you look at the sort of overall structure, the overall trajectory, does it happen in one way, or does it happen with multiple pathways that go from the unfolded to the folded state? And what we found was that for the most part, they followed a single folding route. The only case in which there was an exception was something where there were a couple beta strands and one time one formed before the other time it folded in the opposite direction. We also, when we looked at the unfolded state before it reached the folding transition point, what we found is that you saw certain secondary structure elements that are present in the native protein, and the more frequently you saw them, the more occupancy you saw of those structures, the earlier they tended to form in the folding pathway, and various other things. But the main thing was to simulate it and see whether existing force fields, again, I'll talk about them more, were sufficiently accurate to fold at least some proteins, and the answer turns out to be yes. Yes, and the next one I have is something more recent where we wanted to look at some more complex proteins to see whether ones with a more complex folding landscape also were able to successfully form, and then to learn something about what the nature of that pathway was. So this one is ubiquitin, full-length ubiquitin, and we did a folding simulation that successfully folded. This one was even longer than the others. It was about 1.25 milliseconds or so, and it was performed, I didn't mention this before, but these are at roughly biological simulated temperatures. So what we actually had was a reversible simulation, something where you saw it in equilibrium and you had something that folded, then unfolded, folded, and unfolded, which allowed, for one thing, just to see multiple events, so statistically you could look at it, but also to see whether the order of formation was the opposite and to see whether some things that you would expect in an equilibrated simulation actually held true. But let me just show you this in this case, just to see what the folding of this more complex protein looks like. Just to prepare you for it, you can't even see the termini, but it turns out this is one with 4 hairpins in a beta sheet, I think, and maybe one extra small one. We'll see when it comes up, I'd forgotten. And the tricky part is that the second one of those beta hairpins gets inserted somewhere in the middle of the beta sheet, and that takes that's a high entropy cost because it's got to sort of find where it's going to insert itself, and that's the point where it's making the folding transition. Everything else falls into place pretty quickly. So this is very heavily smooth and non-physical in some sense, but it shows you the overall pathway. So here is the first hairpin, which is easy. This guy here is the one that's got to find its way over there. And it did, and it gave up. Now it's back here. It's actually misregistered. I'm not sure how clearly you'll see it here, but I think that moved up into the, there, that's the correct place. The other hairpins formed. We now have an alpha helix here, a very small 310 helix, and yeah, that's right, so 5. This is a tiny beta strand at the end. But all that happened very quickly once the one end went into the other end. And so we studied these quantitatively in a variety of different ways. The one thing I want to emphasize, though, is that we are not able to successfully simulate the folding, certainly of all proteins, because some just take too long. We know some of them take seconds, in fact, experimentally to fold. But even things that should be within the time scale that's accessible to our current machines, Anton II, there are a number of proteins that don't fold in that time scale. And when you look at it, you can sort of nail down that it's some defect in the physical models, in the force field, and that's of interest. But it's also bad news because it means a lot of the things we'd want to study, we can't. So let me just move on to another thing that's at least peripherally folding related. The one movie I'll show you is not a full one, but and that is for Alzheimer's disease, a key protein that's implicated there is amyloid beta, A-beta, and that is like ballpark 42 residues long or something to that effect. But the part, I actually was going to show you something about the state where we did a long simulation and saw an unstructured a beta, and then all of a sudden it had some temporary structure that it assumed and then came out. Maybe you could stabilize that to prevent aggregation. But where I decided just last night, we're not really far enough with our experimental comparisons. But I did want to show you one thing which is interesting related to Alzheimer's, which is has to do with the formation of potentially toxic, probably toxic, small oligomers, soluble oligomers of fragments of that amyloid beta protein. And there's increasing data now available that those soluble oligomers, the very small ones, may in fact be, if not the toxic, elements that are causing the damage in Alzheimer's disease, at least one of them. But it turns out it's difficult to characterize what those oligomers are and how they work experimentally. And part of the reason is that we know they form, but it's very hard to capture them and see what they look like because, first of all, there are a lot of different structures. When you see, when it's cleaved, you see a lot of transient structures and they look very different from each other. but also, they don't last very long. They're ephemeral. What'll happen is, before long, they sort of move into a different conformation and they form fibrils. So it was hard for people to take a snapshot and see what they looked like. But in simulation, what we were able to do is see six A-beta fragments, and in fact, they were decapeptide fragments at the C-terminal end. It was 10 residues there. And what they did was to assemble in simulation into a hexameric structure. And we're pretty sure the structure is right simply because others have found, David Eisenberg, I guess is the one who first discovered this, that for a related protein, and that's actually called alpha B crystalline, which is not involved in the brain, it's actually found in the formation, implicated in the formation of cataracts. But for that one, it turns out to be a longer-lived species, and so he was able to figure out a crystal structure for that one. And it turns out that the one that we came up with for amyloid beta looks very much like that. So I'll just show you the formation of that. Okay, and in gray we have, in gray what we've actually got is the crystal structure for a different protein, alpha B crystalline. But what you'll see is that the six fragments of amyloid beta form into something that really looks almost exactly like the same structure. It's what David called a cylindron structure, sort of a beta barrel looking structure. Let me just do that once more. And again, you see a lot of cooperativity. When one goes into the correct place, the others form pretty quickly. So we're trying to learn more about this, and hopefully at some point, through experimental work that's complementary, learn something more about whether it is toxic, we're pretty sure it is, but also what the mode is, because we ought to be able to study interactions and other things here that are difficult to probe experimentally, and vice versa. So now let me just say a little bit about ion channels. I forget when I started, but I think I'm okay for a little while longer. Yes. This is a little fragments of what I would have shown, and so it'll be a little disconnected, but I just want to say something about some simulations that we've done with voltage-gated potassium channels, and in particular the KV1.2 potassium channel. And the way they work is that at hyperpolarizing voltages, when it's much more negative inside the cell than outside, the channel, this has been known for a long time, is known to be in a closed state where the potassium ions don't flow through. And then when it depolarizes, when it's more positive inside the cell rather than it is outside, then the channel opens. It's called the activated state. And that's when ions flow from the inside of the cell to the outside. It's relevant biomedically. Both this channel and other ion channels in terms of a variety of things. So if you've got mutations, you can wind up with various cardiac conduction abnormalities, different types of chronic pain, including neuropathic pain, which is very difficult to treat. some forms of paralysis, some types of migraine headaches. So it's relevant from a medical viewpoint anyway. And I want to start just by showing you the internal structure of the channel through which these ions pass. It doesn't really illustrate too much, but it's sort of just fun to see them move through. The colored balls are potassium ions. They're colored differently just so you can follow them because they pop very quickly. And you'll see some little water molecules interposed between these. And then what it does is it stops for a little bit in certain sites that are defined by surrounding carbonyl groups. And then we looked at things like the rate of conduction and some things about the mechanism. Does it push through the potassium ions because of things behind it or a variety of other sorts of things? But the interesting part of these channels actually have to do with the way that the transmembrane voltage regulates this process. And here's a structure, Rod McKinnon structure, from years ago of a Kv1.2 potassium channel. And what you'll see is this center part, this right here, that's the pore of the, that we just saw, the pore of the channel. And then this outside part is the voltage sensor domain, which is used to regulate the channel. So they're sort of, it's a, you know, tetrameric structure, and this guy is sort of shifted over, but that's how it basically works. So one of the questions that we were interested in finding was there were a lot of different hypotheses about it and some real evidence. Other people had done some good work, but it wasn't really known what the structure of the closed state was. The open state is one that Rod solved, but the question was, what is the structure of the closed state? And more importantly, how does it go from opening to closing and vice versa? And this is of the full ion channel, including the voltage sensor domains. So we wanted to know not just how things move, but how the membrane potential induced the structural changes that then resulted in the flow of ions through the channel. So I won't show the actual simulations that are involved. They're actually sort of hard to look at and figure out what's going on. But here's the model that we built, and I should say that details of this are not entirely clear. There's argument about some aspects of it, but the basic structure seems like it's probably consistent enough with the experimental evidence that it holds true. So what we're seeing up here is the activated, the open state, which was known before, and what you're seeing always at the bottom is the interior of the cell, and then the exterior is up here. So in this ion channel, in the voltage sensor domain, there's an alpha helix that has 5 positive charges. Where did it go? There it is. And when the interior of the cell becomes negative, I'm sorry, I'm not used to having the cursor here to point at things, but when the interior becomes very negative, then this helix pulls down because it's positively charged. Then there is a little linker here, a very short alpha helix. The pressure on that is released. So in this picture here, this turns out to be released, and this kind of is spring-loaded a little bit, so that makes it easier to move. But there's another effect that goes on. Here the potassium ions are these little green things, and then you can see faint water molecules around it. Well, the other thing that the negative interior does is it pulls out those charged potassium ions, and that leaves a bunch of water here. Now, the water has no business being there because within the pore, this part of the pore is quite hydrophobic. And you can think of the potassium ions as having been there to keep company with the water. But when the potassium ion channels leave, the water doesn't want to be there. So you have a process of hydrophobic collapse. And that, together with further motions of this helix, relaxes this more, and you see the thing snap shut in our simulation. And then that happens a little more here, and what you wind up with is the resting state, the closed state. Once again, details may be wrong, but it gives you a sense of what's probably the overall cycle between opening and closing. And I'm just going to show you one other. I don't love the movie part itself. It's a little hard to see the ions go through. And in fact, to cheat and let you show that, I'm slowing down the time scale while the interesting stuff is happening. But let me just tell you what it is anyway. So what you're seeing here, it kind of looks like a pore, but it isn't. This is just the voltage sensor domain, one part of the voltage sensor domain. And no ions should pass through there. It's not supposed to. And when it does, it was known, that that caused various sorts of channelopathies, pathological conditions where bad things happen to the patient. So here the potassium ions confusingly are yellow, but what we're going to see is that with this mutation, and these key residues are highlighted, these potassium ions are leaking through there at a pretty slow rate, but still enough to cause serious problems. You're going to basically wind up with an equilibration of the charge that you don't want to have. And I'm going to cut that part off there and talk a little bit about some things that are more directly related to drug discovery, and then tie it off with some depressing stuff about what the limitations of MD simulations are to the extent that we understand that. And one of the depressing things is we don't even know exactly where those limitations are. So we can't identify in advance always whether the simulation is correct. That's true of a lot of experimental techniques also, but it would be really nice to know either, ideally, that the simulation is always correct, or at very least, for this kind of protein, you can't count on the simulation. We can't do that. But first, let's just look at some apparent success cases. So this is a very simple kind of experiment that we did, and I should, you know, all the stuff I'm saying when I say we, it's a fairly large research group, and it's unfair that I'm getting to make this lecture when they did, you know, not just all the work, but it's a big enough group that there are a lot of very gifted people. But in this case, I want to call out one person, Yibing Shan, who did this experiment, even though I would never have let him do this otherwise. So what he did was a fairly simple experiment, which is to start with SARC kinase, which is involved in cancer. And then there was a molecule called PP1, and that ligand was known to bind to SARC. It was originally developed as a potential anti-cancer drug, and I think it was toxic, so it wasn't used, but it's a well-studied model system. This copy of PP1 is going to stay in the same place, just to show you where the actual crystallographically known binding site is. And then what Yibing did is he just released a real copy of it into the water, the surrounding solvent, to see whether it found that binding site. And, you know, if I think I was on vacation or something, and if I had been there, I would have said, yeah, right, that's great. What are the odds it's going to work? You're doing this great work on, he does great work on a lot of things. You know, I wouldn't spend my time on it, but he did it anyway, and the thing worked. So what you're seeing is this molecule searches around. Very quickly, it finds out that it's good to be near the surface of the protein. Fairly soon, it finds itself in what amounts to a little vestibule near the experimental binding site. And then after a little while, it jiggles in and comes extremely close to the known binding site and binding pose. And in fact, if you looked at the water in here, you'd see it's even better than it looks, because they're waters that structurally resolved waters that fill in these gaps. So this one worked really well. And I'm just going to show you a couple other, it's either one or two, I forget, other examples that use real drugs. So this is dasatinib, which is approved for chronic myelogenous leukemia, binding again to SARC kinase. And it also finds the general area, this seems to be a theme we see repeatedly, the general area of where it wants to bind. So there's something that can bind it in several poses, but then it twiddles around and, in this case, embeds itself with some changes in the structure of the protein. Sort of this is an in-between case where it's hard to say whether you'd call this an induced fit, where the ligand causes the protein to change conformation, or conformational selection, where you would see this appear eventually in an APO simulation given long enough, but this comes in there, stabilizes that conformation. But in any case, it goes into a little crevice in there and binds in a very nice way. I have one more. I have no excuse for showing you this, but I love watching these binding movies. This one just with a little spaghetti. but this is lapatinib, another approved drug that's used for breast cancer, and it's attacking epidermal growth factor receptor, and it again winds up in the experimentally correct conformation. So this works, except when it doesn't, and I'll show you somewhere it doesn't in a minute. And then this is one other, it's not a movie, but this was for a protein-protein binding site for a drug that Jim Wells came up with for a company he, I guess, co-founded called Synesis. And it's binding to IL-2. It's the IL-2 receptor binding to IL-2. And this one gets in the way and inhibits the formation of that protein-protein interface. So I guess it's the blue, which is the experimentally known binding pose. And then in our simulation, we wound up with this orange one that has some of the atoms colored differently. The interesting thing about this one is this binding site isn't there normally, and it requires a real induced fit to see it move to the point where this binds. And that's what we saw in simulation and comes out with that binding pose. So those are, you know, actually seeing the binding. You might imagine that it would be interesting or potentially useful to learn things about, for example, the affinity of a given ligand for a protein, ultimately its activity. But it would be nice if you could look and say, this is probably going to be a tighter binder than this other one. So to play around with that, what we did is took a, I guess it should be really on the left, I think, logically. But this is a ligand that is known to bind. And when we do a simulation, starting from the bound state, you'll see it sticks around there for quite a while. I think at a certain point we just cut off the simulation at 15 microseconds, but the protein wiggles around a little bit, but it stays there in its original pose. If you make a very minor modification to that ligand, you wind up with something though that's not stable. And I'll just run that. Very quickly, the conformation shifts in the protein and the ligand winds up moving away. Now, in principle, you might think about actually using this as a way to measure free energy. And in fact, there are known algorithms for computationally determine the free energy of a binding process, you know, free energies of binding or free energies of solvation or other things. It's very computationally intensive, and getting accurate results requires two things, which is accuracy of the force field in the beginning and end state, and also a lot of sampling, a lot of simulation time. And it's not at all clear that running long MD simulations where you simply look at how long it takes, you know, to move from the on state to the off state doesn't do it at all, because you're seeing a kinetic barrier and you're not seeing a purely thermodynamic measurement. If you ran equilibrium simulations and did it back and forth and looked at the occupancy of these two states, then in principle you could also, in a different way, calculate the free energies of binding. And, you know, you can get a rough sense of that. We'll sometimes just look at a potential drug molecule or endogenous ligand and see, this is obviously unstable, this one's staying around, what does it look like? It's not a very good practical technique in most cases to do it. And we played around with, I won't have time to talk about it, but various enhanced sampling techniques where you can use MD simulation sort of as a subroutine in sampling the Boltzmann distribution, where you don't really care to see the overall trajectory. Most of the time when we look at it, we want to see a real movie, a continuous movie of how a molecule changes shape. But sometimes all you really care about is seeing where the low free energy parts, because the Boltzmann formula will tell you how much of the time it should stay there. And in that case, there are various techniques developed by people outside our group almost entirely that can do that sampling more efficiently, or run large numbers of short simulations and get some of that information. But I'm just showing this as a suggestive thing of, you know, some ligands fall off and some stay there, and some of the time it does it when it should do that. Now one other thing in the successful slides, and that is, I guess, the last thing, which is one of the things that we're most interested in doing and have been doing a lot of recently, is looking at the APO proteins, the protein without any ligand, studying it over very long periods of time, and trying to take a look at different conformations that it may assume. And from a drug discovery viewpoint, one interesting question is, are there any conformational states that are relatively unpopulated? You don't see them very much. Sometimes there are things that are formed for very short periods of time and only occur every millisecond or so. So you're going to have a hard time seeing them. But in simulation, if you can see them and they look like they might be a binding pocket, then maybe you can get an idea about how you might design a drug molecule that would fit into that pocket. So this is a phosphatase, and phosphatases are considered not quite undruggable, but historically have been considered to be undruggable. Very hard, you know, it does the opposite of a kinase, but where there are a lot of lichens that attack kinases, some of which are approved drugs, there's very little out there for phosphatases. So we looked at one called SHP2, and for those of you who know phosphatases, there is a more famous and more pharmaceutically relevant one called SHP2, which is also called SHP2. This is the less interesting one from the pharmaceutical viewpoint because it was really just a scientific study. But if we watch it, what we're going to see in this simulation is somewhere around here, a binding pocket is going to appear for a very short amount of time. This is a long simulation, and it's only, I don't know, 100 microseconds or so you'll see here. So it's actually easier to see when it rotates a little bit. There we go. You see how deep that is? There is a little thing that goes way into the center of the protein, and it's not there most of the time, but if you could get a ligand in there, that would be great. This is here just mapping out the interior surface of that pocket. The yellow part is hydrophobic, and then the blue and red indicates charges. This is sort of an odd one. What we've done here is it's a superimposed set of little fragments, so it's hard to resolve them, but it was done to try and see whether it looks, it's sort of a quick and dirty test to see whether things stick in there in a reasonable way, whether it's a good binding pocket. And then here there is a molecule that could be a binder, and in fact it does turn out to bind in the right place and in a fairly stable way. This doesn't always happen, it's a hard thing to do, but what it's illustrating is just one use of MD, which is to look for novel binding pockets, including cryptic binding pockets that you just don't see in most still pictures. So I'm going to quickly just give you a list of things that MD might be able to do in drug discovery, but this doesn't mean that we or anybody else is doing this on a wholesale scale. And the thing, it's important enough to say it first, which is I really don't know what role MD can play in drug discovery. There are a whole bunch of places here where, you know, I just have to believe that MD could be useful in a number of them because you can see what's going on and how things bind and where they bind a lot of the time. But this is unproven, and drug discovery is a long, you know, drug development pipeline is a very long process. Most of the pieces of that pipeline I personally don't understand very well, even when it's explained to me. I don't have a gut level feeling for it. So I'm not making any claims about where it's what it's practical to do at this point. But here are some things where it might make sense. So the most important probably is understanding the biological mechanisms underlying various forms of pathology and an atomic level of detail. And for structure determination, this isn't the way you'd want to do it. Experimental techniques, you know, crystallography, NMR, cryo-EM, there are a number of things there that are much better ways to do that. But the mechanisms, when you want to see a little moving image to see visualize what's going on, MD is really great for that when it works. Another one is to artificially manipulate the protein that you're simulating to make different kinds of mutations. One that in a human might be somatic, you know, mutations, for example, from ionizing radiations, or germline mutations for inherited disorder, and then look at how it changes the effects. And we've been pretty successful in some cases at saying, when this residue is changed, oh look, there's this hinge, it used to go like this, it doesn't anymore, now you have uncontrolled replication. Or even here we have a case where, let's say, Gleevec binds to Abl kinase, and now if there's a mutation in the kinase, now it messes things up, it doesn't work in the same way. Suggestive, not, you know, not anything you can count on, but it's an interesting kind of thing to do, artificial mutation studies. Also taking existing drugs and trying to figure out how they work, or drugs that are, you know, in a congeneric series, drugs that are related to known actives, why don't they work, and what can we learn from that about drug discovery? Next one is just stuff I just showed you, which is identifying cryptic binding pockets or ones that don't last very long, or novel allosteric sites. We may have something where the active site is known, the primary binding site is known, but if you can find something in a remote part of the molecule that looks like a binding pocket and then see it and find that in simulation it modulates the activity by causing structural changes that are remote, that's really interesting scientifically. How do you transduce that signal? But also, maybe it leads to drugs that can be more selective because, you know, you have a lot of conservation for some classes of molecules of those known active sites, the orthosteric sites. But for other, you may have a lot of variation in other places that might allow, first of all, might in ordinary physiology, might allow the drug to be modulated by two or three other modulators, but also pharmaceutically, something which can attack a particular molecule and not another one to get the desired effect. Another one would be predicting binding affinities. I mentioned that to you. But again, that's not terribly reliable yet. It's a field that's been in progress for a long time. If you add up everybody, most of the people researching these areas are elsewhere. And it's a hard one to do computationally. And, you know, of course, it's not that hard in many cases to measure them experimentally, but if you can predict those, especially in a high-throughput manner, sometimes that could make it easier for you not to have to synthesize a number of possible compounds to test. And then another one would be predicting pharmacokinetic properties. You know, how is the drug metabolized? How, you know, does it make its way through the membranes? Does it get into the bloodstream? Those kinds of questions. And the last one, I put a question mark before the bullet point, and that has to do with predicting toxicity. We haven't done anything on that at all, but you might imagine that if you did simulations, you could at least discover some forms of toxicity. Now, doing real things that you do in animals is ridiculous, because if you think of, there are a small number of targets, but an enormously large number of anti-targets, things in the body that you don't want your ligand to attach to. But there are a few sort of usual suspects. There are, for example, proteins where if you attach your drug to it, you wind up with a QT prolongation and a cardiac syndrome called Toussaint de Plante, which is potentially fatal. Also, the cytochrome P450 isoforms, some of those things, they're involved in metabolizing drugs in your liver, and if you have a drug that attaches to one of those, then it can become toxic, or it can just either result in a higher level of other drugs in the body or a lower level of other drugs. So predicting some of those interactions for those specific proteins, maybe that's something MD can help with. But I've got a question mark there because it's very speculative. I don't know if it's useful there. One thing I really know more than anything else, though, is that none of this is going to be a substitute for experiments. To the extent that it's useful at all, it's likely to be complementary to various experimental techniques. And that's something that we know because we have, most of our work actually will have some, when we bring it to the point of publication, the majority of our papers now are done in collaboration with other researchers. We first look at historical data often, but you know, we also like to make predictions, work with experimentalists to see if they're validated, and also to get ideas. You know, the most important thing is we'll work with people who, you know, we work on many molecules, each one, we don't know the biology as well as other people. So we'll have very profitable exchanges where somebody who knows the molecule will say, you know, that's interesting what you found, but nobody's going to care even if it's right. This is something people want to know about. Run a simulation of that. And we'll say, okay, here's what we found, but you can't take this part seriously. And I say, oh, but can you test that? This kind of interaction turns out to be really potentially powerful. So it's just like another kind of instrument to use. And in the drug discovery area, if it works, it's going to work as one component of something where a lot of it will be experimental. So let me just finish up by saying here are a couple, showing you some examples of spectacular failures with MD. So on the bright side, it's very clear now that there are many cases where MD really can help answer important biological questions. The slide that I have that fits into this from previous talks, when I've looked back on them, they're much more, not pessimistic, but we knew much less. Now it's pretty clear that MD simulations, not just in our hands, but in other hands, have generated some real science, generally together with experiment. But it's also equally clear now, and clearer than it was a few years ago, that there are many cases where it can't. Now the limitations really fall largely in two categories. The first one is inadequate sampling, which we use in a very broad sense here, basically meaning you can't simulate for long enough, even on Anton, because there are a lot of complex proteins, either very large or ones with complex dynamics, where even if you could, you know, some things we know biologically how long a particular process takes, and it's too long for Anton. In other cases, we discover that. Sometimes you can get data that tells you you're not sampling enough to get accurate results. But the ones that worry me most, and we're doing well there, are new Antons where, you know, we have Anton 2, Anton 3 is going to be ready in another couple of years or so. And we're going faster than Moore's Law. They get faster and faster. They won't get to the point where you can do all of these simulations, but that gets faster at least, and the scope of things you can do gets longer. The part that's more worrisome is the accuracy of the models used in these simulations, the force field accuracy. So one big question is, how accurate are current molecular mechanics force fields? Not in the abstract, but in terms of the things that are biologically important. We know they're good, we don't know how good, and we unfortunately, as I mentioned before, don't know always how to recognize the situations in which we can rely on the results and when we can't. Again, true of many experimental techniques, but it would be really good to know which things we can rely on. Now, the next thing is, can we fix it? What's wrong with the force fields? What can we do to fix it? There's nothing on this list that we came up with ourselves. These are things that are floating around, have been floating around for a long time in the community as possibilities. They include things like polarizability. Most of the simulation that's been done over the years, although not all, has been done with a fixed charge model. And what that basically says is that for purposes of your MD simulation, every atom, you assume that it has a fixed partial charge, which remains the same throughout the course of the simulation. And that's non-physical. What actually happens is, you know, if you've got this partial charge sitting here and there's a negative charge that comes near it, it distorts the shape of the electron cloud, really in a quantum mechanical way, but at very least it's going to drag it in the direction suggested by Coulomb's law, more or less. And that's not even reflected in these fixed charge force fields. So one possibility is use polarizable force fields. Many people have worked on them, we are now too. But getting them to actually work well, they're slower. They're often like even 10 times slower. Maybe we can make them 3 times slower, but that's not the big concern. The big concern is seeing whether we can actually make them materially better than fixed charge force fields. And one problem is that introduces new parameters. And one of the risks of having lots of parameters to adjust is overfitting the data. If you have a finite amount of data, either quantum mechanical data or experimental data, both of which we use very extensively, sooner or later, if you have enough parameters, you run out of data and you wind up finding patterns that don't exist, which in the financial world, which I've been out of for 16 years now, I guess, you know, results in you having great things that don't predict and don't make you any money. In this world of doing biological simulations, what that means is generally a lack of transferability. Come up with a force field that works very well for one protein, or especially for ligands, because ligands have much more variability than stringing together 20 different types of amino acids in a chain. And so what you find out is you apply that force field to another different kind of molecule, and it's just terrible. It just doesn't work very well. So, you know, that's just a way of saying, yes, that's a known effect, but you have to be careful with it. That's just one. Another one is point charges. In a classical, not by comparison with quantum, but in a standard kind of molecular mechanics force field, you represent those charges, those partial charges or even polarizable ones, as being centered at a point. And that's also not what you have. What you have is this quantum electron cloud, and it sort of diffuses out. So what can you get by representing those as diffuse clouds? And we're playing around with, you know, exponentially diffuse clouds, which have some appeal theoretically. Then when atoms get close enough that there's a significant interpenetration of those electron clouds, it's supposed to behave differently. Does that matter or not? And we don't know. Hydrogen bonds is another embarrassment, you know, within the field. It's one of these things where it's not clear why these simulations work at all, but there's a lot of cancellation of errors, and they seem to more often than you would think. But hydrogen bonds, it turns out, we know they're directional. You know, the angle between the hydrogen bond donor and acceptor is going to determine the strength of the bond and the formation of the bond in the first place. That's handled electrostatically, purely electrostatically in most force fields. So it doesn't matter where you are, it's just how far they are apart, the donor and acceptor are. That's really wrong. Can we improve that through directionality? Early attempts to do that some years ago were actually worse, but force fields have been evolving over a, 30-year period now, and so any new change is likely to mess something up. So that's another one. One that we've recently found some problems with, when I mentioned the over-collapsed unfolded states of proteins, we were trying to track down what was going on, and an interesting thing that I would have never predicted is that dispersion term. It's the 1 over r to the 6th one I showed you before, which is basically, and it's often said wrong, it's an induced dipole. So, you know, without the quantum mechanical stuff, you would represent it here, if you represented it this way at all, as a 1 over r to the 6th term plus a 1 over r to the 8th plus 1 over et cetera, all even number terms infinitely out there. And sort of seemed like with the length that you see, you know, going up to 1 over r to the 6th ought to be plenty. Turns out it's not. It turns out that for some things, especially in water, it actually appears that fixing some of those at least changes some of the gross misbehavior of the unfolded proteins. Can't be sure, that's just one thing to change, but it looks like that does matter, and other things. So we played around with patching them. We made various force field patches that seem to improve things and don't make various other things too much worse, but it's not the same as really figuring out what's going wrong. There's also combining rules, the 1 over r to the 6th and the 1 over r to the 12th. The way they're combined is you perform either an arithmetic average or a geometric average of certain parameters. That's kind of arbitrary and wrong. So maybe by having a table structure, a two-dimensional table, you could improve things. Who knows? The scariest thing is, what if the whole functional form is wrong? Those five terms that you add together, they bear no obvious, well, that's not true, too strong. The quantum, you know, the Schrodinger wave equation doesn't look like that. It doesn't have these five terms. There are places where the Coulomb interaction shows up, but it's actually nothing like the molecular mechanics model. It's a very weird, you know, set of effects, and abstracting that to the level of what higher level forces are actually involved is tricky. And so one of the things that's scary is, what if the whole functional form is wrong? How do we search for a better functional form? Especially because that space is enormously large, infinite, but, you know, basically just grows really quickly, the space of all functions on some manifold. So with a finite amount of data, how are we ever going to find that? Or just something else we haven't thought of. Those unknown unknowns are scary in this area. So, you know, again, we know we can do a lot already, but how far can we push MD simulations? We don't know, and the biggest thing that, you know, might limit it, I think, is those physical models. And even if we can fix those, even if we as a field, not necessarily our group, can figure out what's wrong, what if it turns out that there's no good, efficient way to compute this? Because there's no guarantee there wouldn't be. Nature's really good at this stuff. It solves the Schrodinger equation instantaneously and correctly. How do we know that we can do it with a computationally tractable form? We don't. Now, there's one thing that is, oh, I think I've got this in two places, so skip the last line. Let me just move over to show you a couple of the horror cases, two little movies. So one of them is known force field problems that we've seen in protein folding. So this is a particular domain. It's a PDZ domain in I actually can't even remember which protein this domain is in, where we weren't able to fold it. But then, in trying to understand, well, is it a sampling problem, or has it got stuck on the other side of a kinetic barrier? What happened here? An obvious experiment to do is start with a known crustal structure or some known structure, and then run it and see if it stays there with our current force field. And this is what happens when we did this with this particular one. So let me just tell you the part to watch. This alpha helix right here is going to unwind, and it's going to go into the wrong place when we run it with the same force field that successfully folds the other proteins, many of the other proteins. So it's going to, there we go, it's unfolding, and it's going to completely the wrong place and causing, other sorts of changes. And it does this not just once, it's repeatedly doing the wrong thing. So this is not a sampling problem, it's something wrong with the physics, and we don't know what. And you might say, well, okay, make it so it stabilizes alpha helices more. People have worked on that, but it destabilized those, and it tends to preferentially stabilize beta sheets, and you can sort of titrate that and get somewhere in the middle, but it's not really solving the problem. Something's wrong. Helices have some cooperativity that aren't captured in these classical models, things with quantum mechanical character that aren't captured by the classical models. Maybe it's something to do with that, but all we know is it doesn't work. And that means if we did a Cas-like experiment, we can hardly hope to have it search and find the right structure if it doesn't know where the structure is. It might do a great job of getting to something it thinks is the free energy minimum, but it isn't. And I'll just give you one example now for ligand binding. This is one where there is a known binder, an 8 micromolar binder, which is not bad, to PT1B, another phosphatase. So it's going to, this is its known binding structure, and you see it, first of all, change the conformation, the binding pose, and then just become destabilized, so it dissociates. And it shouldn't dissociate this fast. In fact, when we're doing a simulation of this sort, there's not that much solvent, so the effective simulated concentration, I won't go through it, but you're actually simulating an infinite lattice with periodic boundary conditions, so you can define the concentration, but that concentration is very, very high. This one shouldn't dissociate in any length of time we could look at, but it does. And again, this is one where we can point toward the force field, but we don't know exactly what's wrong with it. So one, I think this is the last slide, it's just so we don't get depressed. The one thing that I think is nice to think about is if we understood force field limitations and understand where they came from, then even if we couldn't find a computationally tractable way to do simulations that are always more accurate, we might learn some very interesting things from a biophysical viewpoint. For example, if we can learn that certain sorts of physical effects are more important biologically than we thought, then that could tell us something about the abstraction we've got to understand how living things actually work. Because just saying, you can always have the trivial model, which pure physicists often will do, which is, why do biology, why do biophysics in particular? Because you already know it follows the Schrodinger equation or the relativistic Schrodinger equation. What more is there to learn? And of course, in science, what it actually is you build up theories on top. You build up abstractions that capture key emergent properties of the systems you're studying. So what are those emergent properties? If you have something like our current force field, which parts of it matter and which don't? And the which don't, actually, is very interesting, too, from a theoretical viewpoint. For example, I have a hunch that the long-distance electrostatic interactions with when they're not close to the surface or the first water shell or so, it may be that those distant interactions we're computing more accurately than we need to, and that they're not biologically relevant. Some, you know, there are all sorts of things that if you just try that, that break, and so you don't really know the right answer to that, but maybe that's not biologically important. And in answering these kind of questions, I don't know how to answer it. Many of you probably know more than I do, but I think about, well, wait, this is probably not important because nature has to have some redundancy. After all, the you know there's random molecular motion. It's going on at a non-zero temperature, and it still has to work. So wouldn't nature design it in a way that's fairly robust? But then sometimes I'll think, well, no, actually, you want metastable states because you want to have these exquisite balances where little interactions here from a ligand can induce major structural changes. So maybe it's really sensitive to some of these errors because nature doesn't have those errors and it's trying to balance it. I don't even know how to think about it. But if we did, if we could figure something out about all this, then maybe somebody will at some point be able to use that to help build a theory that tells us how is nature actually using physics to make biology. So at least that maybe is a silver lining if we can't simulate it perfectly to understand something about what the physics is that actually matters biologically. That's all I've got. I think we're not able to do questions here. We're not going to, but I'm going to be hanging around, so I'm glad to talk to anybody who wants to talk about something. Thank you.